Hi, I'm Richard Maraj, Senior Minister at Unity of Phoenix Spiritual Center, and I want to thank you for visiting our website and for tuning in to today's message. If you feel inspired by today's talk, I really encourage you to make a donation by hitting that button below and making a contribution to this ministry. It'll allow us to continue these messages online and to do the great work we do here at Unity of Phoenix, which is to inspire people to live better lives. So thanks for tuning in, thanks for your support, and we hope to see you at a Sunday real soon.
Morning again, everyone. And a shout out to everybody who tunes in and watches us online. So how many people have ever had a time in your life where you were working and trying and trying and trying, but your life wasn't improving or progressing in the way that you really wanted it to? Anybody? And how many ever been so frustrated that your life wasn't going the way you wanted? In fact, it was going in the wrong direction. And out of desperation, you said something like, "Help me, God. Help me. God, give me a break. Help me." Anybody desperate like that? Kind of reminds me of this guy named Jack. And he's hiking on this really steep cliff. And he slips and he's falling. And he grabs this branch. And he looks down and he sees like it's a 1,000-foot drop. And then he realizes that also he can't get from the branch to climb up on the rock, and so he's just stuck there. And he's absolutely terrified. And so he starts screaming, "Help! Somebody help! God, help me! Help me!" And then God's voice says, "Jack, do you trust that I love you?" He said, "Yes, God, I trust that you love me. I mean, do you really trust me?" "Yes, God, I trust you." "Then I want you to listen to exactly what I tell you and follow it, and you're going to be just fine." "Okay, God, I'll do anything. I'll do anything. Just help save me." And then God says, "What I want you to do is let go of the branch." And then a very long silence. And then Jack says, "Is there anybody else up there?" All right. Okay. So today, we continue with our annual Songs of Life series. This is week 3 of our 4-week series this year, and it is on the music of the rock group Queen. And the reason we do this every year, I've been doing it for about, I think, 18 or 19 years now, is because music does something to us. It takes us to a place, it opens our heart, it inspires us, it helps us, you know, find greater peace, or sometimes go to that sad place to help us open our hearts to heal in greater ways. I bet every one of us has some favorite song that got us through a difficult time, something that was our personal anthem to help us overcome. And so in the first week, we looked at I Wanna Break Free, and then last week, we looked at Under Pressure, and today, we're going to look at the song Somebody to Love. In many ways, this is my favorite Queen song to just play over and over and over and over again. I just love it. It's written by Freddie Mercury, and it's really it was his inspiration for gospel, a bit of a gospel sound, because he really loved Aretha Franklin. And so that was the source of this. And the thing is, I love this song, and even though it kind of sounds like it's a bit of a downer and a desperate thing, you know, find me somebody to love, it kind of sounds needy. It's kind of, we're looking for love outside of ourselves. I find it's a profoundly fun, joyful, uplifting, and inspiring song. And particularly, I find it's a very relatable song. It feels there's something so real about what this person's going through, something so authentic. I think it resonates in all of us at some level. So while most of the verses are kind of down and depressed, overall, I think the feel of this song is not only uplifting and inspiring, but kind of has a powerful message for us in how to live our lives more fully and freely. So I want to just kind of read, I usually don't read as much of the verses, but they're just so powerful. And I won't do the chorus, I'll just do the verses and then comment on them. "Each morning I get up, I die a little, can barely stand on my feet, take a look in the mirror and cry, 'Lord, what are you doing to me?' I spent all my years in believing you, but I just can't get no relief, Lord. I work hard every day of my life. I work till I ache in my bones. I take home my hard-earned pay all on my own. I get down on my knees and I start to pray till tears roll down my eyes, Lord." And so clearly he is not having a good day. And sometimes in life, we've all had times in life where we feel a little beat up, a little knocked down, and we're really low. And sometimes it's hard to get out of bed. You know, we feel so far from the life that we want, so far from feeling the love and the peace and the joy that we all want in our lives, that we just feel down. We feel a little bit hopeless. And we feel like we've lost our joy and our drive. Not only feeling distant from the desire and the life we want, but the song clearly shares a feeling disconnected from God, feeling in some way that God has abandoned us and God isn't helping. And then it continues in the third verse, and it gets worse. Every day, I try and I try and I try, but everybody wants to put me down. They say I'm going crazy. They say I got a lot of water in my brain. I got no common sense. I got nobody left to believe in. And fourth verse, got no feel, I got no rhythm, I just keep losing my beat. As if feeling sad, disconnected from God, far from your dreams, working hard and getting nowhere wasn't enough, we pile on that nobody loves me. They think I'm crazy. And that I'm out of sync. I've lost my rhythm. I've just lost it. And so right now at this point, it's like about as low as you could go in terms of how you feel. And yet there's something that kind of, as I listen to it, that softens it. You know, sometimes, you ever had a time and you felt like you were the only one that was hurting? Sometimes you feel like the only one that was betrayed, the only one that had this severe loss or pain in our lives. Something I think that's really neat is sometimes being able to relate and realize that other people and we are all suffering in some ways. It sort of alleviates our own suffering to know that other human beings are going through this. You know, when I struggled in my early years as a minister, wondering if I wanted to be one and having a bit of a crisis of faith, one of the most relieving and wonderful things, and I felt guilty about that, I felt bad, it's like a minister shouldn't be feeling this. I read an article by Mother Teresa who shared that she wondered if there was really a God. She wondered if she was doing the right thing. She wondered if she was her life was making any difference at all. And I felt such relief. And not a joy that somebody else was suffering, but was that it almost made it okay that I was struggling. I found a level of peace and acceptance and even understanding. And it actually helped me handle that process and that process as it continues in my life. I think that same principle is why groups like AA and Al-Anon and Gamblers Anonymous and grief groups work. It's because when everyone shares what they're going through, there's something that gives comfort and ease, and it even creates a common bond and a connection in our humanity. So that was the philosophical reason why it softens it. Now let's get to the lyrical, and that in this fourth verse is where it really everything changes. And so I'll repeat the line and share where it changes. Got no feel, got no rhythm, I just keep losing my beat. And here's where it turns. I'm okay, I'm all right. I ain't gonna face no defeat. I just gotta get out of this prison cell. One day, I'm gonna be free. And for me, that's the game changer right there. From all those verses of feeling down and things aren't working well and nobody likes me, suddenly hope arises. Suddenly the tables are turned from all of that negative in one moment of reclaiming his power, what I call a moment of awakening. A moment where we say, that's enough. That this job, this relationship, my health, how I'm treating myself, how I'm living, I deserve better than this. That no matter how down I am, I can rise up. No matter how much I'm struggling, I can make a change and transform my life. Like Maya Angelou's poem, "And Still I Rise." That no matter what, we can still rise. Let me give you a biblical example. Remember the story of the prodigal son? Asks for his inheritance, takes it, squanders all of his money, and then he's there eating slop with the pigs. And here is my favorite line in the whole story, and it's the game changer. So he's eating with slop with the pigs, and it says, and then he came to himself. There was a moment of awakening where he decided to reclaim his power and realize he deserved to live a better life than this. And that he was ready to change. And the next line says, and he rose up and he started toward his father. He rose up and he started towards God, towards the source, towards the life he was meant to live. You know, this idea about coming to yourself, about you know, reclaiming our power, about having a moment of awakening, helps us with three things. Number one, it helps us realize we have it in us, that we have the power in us, we have the choice in us to change and transform our lives. The kingdom of God is within you. You shall do the things that I've done, and even greater than these. You know, in the book of John, one of my favorite scriptures, it says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never overcome the light. There is a light in you that no darkness can overcome. That we all have the ability in us to bounce back. And whether it's from depression, addiction, bankruptcy, divorce, we have that power and ability in us. That moment of awakening lets us know, I have the power to change and improve and transform my life. The second thing it lets us realize is that it's never too late. It is never too late to improve. It's never too late for life to get better. Remember the story of the woman who was hemorrhaging for 12 years and that she broke through the crowd and touched the hem of Jesus' garment and she was healed? The thing I love about that, 12 years. You would think at some point you might give up. You think at some point you might think it's hopeless, but she got up on that day and she walked to wherever Jesus was, and it says the crowd had pressed up, so the crowd was full right up against Jesus, and she pressed through that crowd to touch the hem of his garment. Never too late. No matter how many mistakes, how many failures, no matter how things gone wrong, it is never too late. And with God, there's always a possibility in this and every moment that things will get better. How many people remember Susan Boyle? Anybody remember? And so at 47, her mother encouraged her to go on Britain's Got Talent. And so she was scared because she thinks she wasn't good looking and they would judge her on her looks and they'd make fun of her. And finally, as a tribute to her mom, she decided to go try out. When they asked her the question, so why are you doing this? She said, I want to be a professional singer, and I want to be as good as Elaine Page. And people snickered in the crowd. They rolled their eyes, all judging her on the way she looked. And then she sang from Les Mis, I Dreamed a Dream. And it tore up the room, melted hearts, inspired people. She got signed to a contract, released her album, and it became, at the time, the single greatest debut album in sales. Never too late. Never too late. Peter Roget was a doctor and a lecturer, and he retired at 61, and he really had a struggle with depression. And to avoid his depression, he did something that brought him comfort. He'd like make lists. He liked to make lists of words. That was at 61. At 73, compiling a whole bunch of lists, he published his book, Roget's Thesaurus, with 15,000 words. One of the probably widely used thesauruses in the world. You know, somebody once gave me a horrible thesaurus, or the worst. Not only was it terrible, it was terrible. Think about that one. That's a good joke. She was so terrible, he didn't have another word for terrible. Okay. Oh, you got it. You just didn't think it was funny. Oh, okay. Now I get it. The joke was terrible. All right. And the third thing it does for us is it has us realize that the thing we struggle with was the thing that helped us rise. See, it's that woman's health issue that helped her rise that day to believe that she could get healthy. It was Roget's depression that helped him, that propelled him to write the thesaurus. It was Susan Boyle's 47 years and feeling like she couldn't win because of her looks that propelled her. All the things that we struggle in life actually are the seeds of what help us rise. The seeds are what make us choose to stand up and keep going and changing our lives. You know, even this shoulder rotator cuff tear has brought me some great and powerful lessons and blessings. As things move, I realize it has been the catalyst for some good things in my life. You know, and one of the first ones is it's really helped awaken me to my level of self-care and what my commitment is to take care of myself, to stay healthy for the years. I made changes in my home, I'm changing in my life to ensure that I not only get back to 100%, but I have years and years of health. Another thing it has taught me is patience. I didn't want patience, but it gave me that blessed opportunity to be more patient. Another thing it did, in many ways, it helped revive my passion and my love for ministry. It helped me revive my love for Unity of Phoenix, for our staff, for our board, you know, for these Sundays that we get to experience together. There's something fabulous about it. You know, and in some ways, in my meditation, I've gotten clarity. Sometimes you like look at your life and think you're a little out of balance, man. Like there's some areas where I've closed my heart off, closed my life to. And it's been calling me to open myself socially, open myself personally, to experience a deeper connection, and to open up my heart fully to love in some areas that I've been scared or held back or afraid to love. You know, it's the areas that we struggle in that I believe help us break free from the prison cells and help us rise up. These things are not obstacles and roadblocks, they're springboards. They're catalysts to help us move to another level. So after that verse comes where he says, you know, I'm all right, I'm okay, I'm not gonna face defeat, then I'm gonna break free, then it goes into that chanting, find me somebody to love. It's one of my favorite parts of the song. Isn't that cool, that chanting? And they do it 10 times. Interestingly, two things about that. One, 10 is the number of completion spiritually. So there's a wholeness about opening yourself to love. And the other one is chanting. You know why chanting works? It's short, repeated things over and over again. Because chanting helps you get beyond the intellect. If you keep repeating it, at some point it'll drop in deeper. And it'll really help you open your heart and your mind in a greater way by just repeating it over and over. The mind stops working and you get deeper into your heart and it can bring incredible change. Find me somebody to love, or find me somebody to love, is really to me an intention when it's chanted that way. It is an intention that we open up to the universe to say, I am ready to open my heart to love in a way I haven't loved before. To feel love in a way I haven't before, to express love in a way I haven't before, to allow myself to be loved in a way I haven't before. Intention. When you set an intention, the universe begins to move. Things that are not for your highest will fall away. Things that are for your highest will move towards you. And things not just on the outside will change, you will change inside when there is a clear intention. And could you imagine, as powerful as intention is, how much more powerful an intention to love is? An intention to open your heart to love in a deeper and greater way. Every one of us wants love. I bet at this time, everybody in this room has some area in your life where you want to experience more love. And whether it's romantic or family or whatever, it doesn't matter. I bet every one of us is yearning for more love. We all want love. And the power of setting an intention for love, it should be easy to open up to love then, shouldn't it? But so many of us are afraid to love. We're afraid to share our hearts. We're afraid to be vulnerable. We're afraid to be honest with the people that are closest to us, sometimes even honest with ourselves. Sometimes we withhold love, the very thing we want, we withhold it. Sometimes we withdraw from love, sometimes we walk away from love, sometimes we run from love. Remember the runaway bride? Running from love. Sometimes we define this, these circumstances have to happen, otherwise there'll be no love. Sometimes we can't sort of color outside the box and love beyond what we know. And one of the most difficult is when we withhold love from ourselves. Find me somebody to love is really your soul saying it's time to open up. It's time to let go. It's time to release and free yourself to live a more full life. Because love is really the thing we all want. You know, my dad didn't have the best upbringing. His mom died when he was 11 years old. And his father was not only not affectionate or loving, he was very abusive. And, so my dad didn't get a lot of that. And so in older, he was not very affectionate. He was not a guy to ever say, I love you. And then things were so bad with his own dad, they sent him to live with a family member who really kind of shunned him and didn't really kind of invite him in and nurture him. And so my dad really struggled about receiving love. He often would push love away. He had very destructive, self-destructive behaviors. He had a tough time. The best thing that happened in his life, he was 17 years old. He met my mom. My father had a man face. You know, like you could like be like a 15-year-old and they look like a man? My father looked like a man at 11. And I know this is going to sound crazy, but my father was 17 and my mother was 25. And they got married like a year later because of the man face. And so, so my dad met my mom and he knew he'd met the woman of his dreams. He totally fell for her. He knew that'd be the woman he'd be with. My mom, on the other hand, couldn't quite stand him. And, and in fact, she called him the wrong name when they first met. His nickname, or the name he went by, was Sonny. And so she turned to him and said, Harry? And so, woman of his dreams, and he's like, Harry? And so it just, but their time together was really interesting. When we were kids, there were some times of some real self-destructive behavior that was unstable and scary to live through. But it was interesting to watch my father over time to see how my mother's love helped make him feel safe and helped him open up. If you fast forward it, in his last couple of years of living, and he was not well, it was probably the happiest of his life. He allowed more love in. He said, I love you more than he ever said. You know, he let himself be love and express love. And so it was probably the greatest example of seeing how love can heal us. I mean, love can open us and transform us if we let it. And he also made me realize we all have something that we need to let love heal in our lives. We all have some limit that we need to allow ourselves to express love in a new way we haven't, or to let us feel love in a way we haven't let ourselves feel it before, or be loved in a way we haven't allowed love to be in our lives. Having done tons of weddings in 21 years of being a minister, one pattern I always notice, whether the bride and groom are in their 20s, or 30s, or 40s, or 50s, or even 80s last year, when the groom was 85 and his young bride was 76. And I've done a vow renewal for a couple that were in their mid-90s, is that regardless of the age, love lights you up. That when you are in love, I mean, it is amazing the energy and the joy that radiates. That's how powerful love is. And we close our heart and shut ourselves off from love, from the thing that can elevate us, the thing can expand us. And the most beautiful thing I think about love is God gives us so many different ways to experience love. We always think romantic love and that's it, and I have love or don't have love based on romantic love. You know, I have a love for my sisters and brothers that's incredible. I have love for longtime friends. We laugh our butts off together and you feel so connected. I've met some new friends recently, and I'm just loving that wonderful experience. The love of holding a baby, the love of loving a puppy. God has given us so many ways to love. We could never run out of love. And I'm not trying to pretend that love's easy, because it's not. In fact, relationships are really very much like algebra. Was that a smooth segue or what? No. You know, relationships are very much like algebra. Ever look at your ex and wonder why? Boom! Come on. So love, it is a crazy, crazy thing. You know what's funny? In picking these songs, as I picked them because I love them and I resonate with them, but the first three songs are really all different aspects about love. Because really, when it comes down to it, that's what it's really about. And so let's not rob ourselves or hold ourselves back from love. Yeah, we're going to have some tough days. Days that are hard to get out of bed. But we can come to ourselves. Even if we slip down many times, we can keep coming back to ourselves, you know, and rising above. And the most important thing to do is to know that it's in you. It's never too late. And that thing that you're hiding from, it is the thing that'll elevate you. But the most important thing is, are you willing to open your heart and love in a way you haven't loved before? Because if we want our lives to change, we need to set a clear intention to find somebody to love. God bless you all.